It's my pleasure to introduce someone who does not really need any introduction, as he's a living legend in the circles of architecture. I would like to warmly welcome Sir Peter Cook and his wife, Yael Reisner, who is also an architect in her own right and with us today. Sir Peter Cook has been a central figure within the global architecture world for over half a century. He is the founder of Archigram, the avant-garde architectural group from the 1960s that was extremely innovative and changed the course of architectural thinking and design for many generations up until today. He's also former director of the Institute of Contemporary Art in London and the Bartlett School of Architecture. His ongoing contribution to architectural innovation was most recently recognized through an honorary doctorate by the University of London, Sweden. Peter Cook's achievements with Archigram have been the subject of numerous publications and public exhibitions and were recognized by the Royal Institute of British Architects in 2004, when members of the group were awarded the RIBA's highest award, the Royal Gold Medal. In 2007, Peter Cook was knighted by the Queen for his services to architecture. He's also a Royal Academic and a Commandeur of Arts de Lettres of the French Republic. Peter Cook has from the very beginning made waves in architectural circles. However, it is in the last few years that the construction of the Kunsthaus Graz in Austria has brought his work to wider public attention. A process set to continue in his practice with Gavin Robertum as CRAB Studio, an abbreviation for Cook Robertum Architectural Bureau, and with the construction of institutional buildings in Vienna, Austria, and Bond, Australia, and more projects on the board. Peter has also built in Osaka, Nagoya, Berlin, Frankfurt, and Madrid. But Peter Cook is more than that. He is a remarkable educator, a tireless mentor for many generations of young architects, and a strong proponent of the advancement of architecture. I feel very fortunate that I was able to experience him as a student many years ago when he was the director of the Bartlett. And I remember that in reviews he would not only criticize the project, but rather try to understand what the story was about the student in front of him, all in an attempt to give him or her a personalized critique that would propel not only a student's design, but moreover, the personality as a designer. Such critiques had much more fundamental and lasting effects than anything else. Since then, wherever I would go in the world, I would meet people that knew Peter, experienced him, or met him in some way. I remember one moment when I was a young graduate interviewing for an assistant professor position with Matthias Sauerbruch and Dagmar Richter at the Art Academy in Stuttgart, Germany. 5 minutes into the demanding interview, the topic switched to Peter Cook, and suddenly the room lit up with his energy. Everyone citing quotes, sharing witticisms, smart pointed statements about architecture that they have grasped from their experiences with him. I'm extremely pleased that we are able to experience this wonderful energy here tonight. And I would like you to join me in welcoming Sir Peter Cook.
It's not the first time I've given a lecture. Very often you get somebody introducing you who simply looks up your Wikipedia slot. And it's nice to get one from somebody who actually was there and knew, or is there and knows. And it's going to be quite a long lecture, and that's why the seat is here in case it gets so long I need to sit down. It has a funny title. The title started because I wanted to get across the idea that one is confronted by many, many different criteria, many, many different experiences, and many, many different things that are going on simultaneously in your mind, and occasionally they almost collide, they almost sort of hit each other nose to nose. That's one interpretation. Second interpretation is that as I get older, I notice, and my wife has observed it too, that I'm more and more interested in people. And I'm interested in, I think it comes from 50 years of teaching, that you can't just take something sort of in the abstract, but you're fascinated by the funny things that go on that lead up to it. Again, there are strange nose-to-nose situations. There is a third interpretation, which will emerge towards the end of the lecture. I don't know whether you have lights that go down in this really terrific room, actually, one of the best rooms I've lectured in. I've always wanted to have a capsule hanging over my head, and whatever it did. But it wouldn't mind if we had a bit less, unless you're trying to televise it or something. But even if you are, can you see the picture? Well, okay, anyway, here goes. Well, here doesn't go. Oh, right. Yeah. I was a provincial child. In England, that means something. I think England and France are the two countries where the term being a provincial is a loaded term because everything goes on respectively in Paris or in London. And I didn't get to London until I was already way into my architectural studies. And I lived in a number of old towns. My dad had been an army officer, and I moved from town to town. And I was surrounded by old stuff. I lived in Norwich, for example, for a while, which has 40 medieval churches. And if you live in a town that's got 40 medieval churches, after you've seen about six of them, you've got the general hang of it. And there are sort of 35 more or whatever. And it has a cathedral that looks like a cathedral and a castle that looks like a castle. And I, in fact, used to collect such stuff. I used to insist on my parents taking me out in the car to some rubbish heap of rubble at the end of a field because it happened to have been a Roman place, you know. So I did that, went there, and I started making balsa wood cathedrals when I was about 14. And then I started reading in the local public library. And by about 15, I'd been there, done that. I was into Corbusier. And by 16, I was looking at stuff like Gunnar Asplund's building that, of course, was pulled down long before I was born. It was the temporary restaurant of the Stockholm exhibition of 1930. But I'd never seen anything like it in Norwich or any of the other towns that I lived in. It looked like an aeroplane. It looked so light. It looked so amazing and floaty and new and transparent and different. And then a weird... And I also collected memories. And I was very turned on by this particular place, which I lived in, a little tiny town called Felixstowe, seaside town. I lived there when I was about 13 or so. And I was bewitched by this combination of buildings here. It's a fun fair. In fact, of course, what I realized later was it was my first sight of a megastructure, which is what really the helter-skelter is. It was probably my first sight of a piece of expressionism, which is what the crazy house at the bottom is. And in fact, it was my first sight of Art Deco. Not brilliant Art Deco, but East Anglian Art Deco, because that's what the restaurant is. There was a megastructure, a piece of expressionism, and a piece of Art Deco. Wow! I mean, that's hot stuff, you know? But then things came more to fruition because I, for the longest provincial period, I lived in a town called Bournemouth, which is a large seaside town, developed in the Victorian era as a bourgeois sort of resting place. Pineland walks, which still exist, were very much a feature of that town. But at the same time as living in this sort of Victorian atmosphere, I was reading Corb. And my first architectural studies were in a little architecture school, a branch of an art school, sounds familiar, and it was in the bowels, or in fact in the church hall, of this particular church, which is a rather good neo-Gothic church. In fact, Bournemouth is full of high-quality neo-Gothic, if you have a taste for such things. But at the same time, there I was in the bosom of this neo-Gothic, and I was already starting to read about people like Burley Marx. I didn't know who they were. They were weird and Brazilian and a long way away and very different. Incidentally, I started architecture school at 16, which was in the last year at which it was legal to do such a thing. And there are a few sort of minor places that let you do that. So here was another dichotomy. Furthermore, this particular school was the last place where you did, in fact, the École des Beaux-Arts curriculum. We had to learn how to draw all the five orders of architecture by proportion. We had to get pieces of lead and trace them around the Gothic. We had to do measured drawings. We had to look at Victorian books of grammar of ornament and trace every Assyrian temple from Bannister Fletcher. It was an extraordinary recherche kind of atmosphere. It was the last place in England that was still doing that. So it's very odd. You had this kid who'd been already looking at, was a modernist, going to the most extreme reversing. I'm not sure that it did any harm. Certainly when I came to London, when I came to the AA, and I met all sorts of funny people, and I had a rather good experience at the AA. I was studying under Peter Smithson, under James Gowan, and my history teacher was John Summerson. It was a high period, but it was sort of correct in a way, and I have a suspicion that the Archigram cook was more the seaside cook that had sort of come back again. Well, you can see in the photograph that by the time I'd met these other people, incidentally, none of whom were at the same school, that I got into leather jackets and such things. And I would say that the Archigram group is interesting because it is not a homogeneous group. It was always a kind of coalition of different opinions, 10 years between the oldest and the youngest, totally different taste in clothes, music, girls, food, etc. I think no two exactly the same. I think that was its strength, because in a sense it was like being in a rather good school studio where there are all sorts of different things going on, and rivalries within it. And if you talk to the other three of the surviving members, I think you will get different readings of the period, and I think that is also healthy. And then I, in that period, did a project called Plug-in City. And it was at that moment, in fact 1964, when, having been brought in by the AA as a critic many times, I was a sort of stroppy, opinionated person, and I come in from the office and shoot my mouth off and then go back again. And I did this presumably so successfully or so often that they said, look, cut the crap and come on the faculty, which I did. But here is a thing that has affected me, I think, grossly. I had published Plug-in City about 5 or 6 weeks before starting to teach. My job, I was hired in a very normal, lowly, I was the assistant to the fifth year master, and the assistant to the fifth year master and be a useful, quiet chap who goes into a room and then tells you where to put the staircase. No such luck, because this thing had been published, this Plug-in City, and it had not been published obscurely. It had been published in the most popular weekend newspaper that's read by 2 million people. The Sunday Times colour supplement had pages of this daft project. And I was told by various of the students who became friends of mine later, they said, we thought, my God, we're going to be taught by this loony. You know, do we have to do this kind of stuff? And I think I spent my first year of teaching realizing that teaching is not, not that I ever thought it was, but realizing it wasn't to do with imparting your particular preferences upon people, or necessarily just telling them where to put a staircase, but understanding their psychology, added to which 10 of them were either my age or older. And that was a sort of baptism by fire. And one became, I suppose, a sort of amateur psychologist over the period. The project is much documented. There are people who have all sorts of opinions about what Archigram was about. One of them is a prominent English academic on the West Coast, not far from this city, with whom I disagree, because he's only really interested in the sort of politics of the situation. It doesn't seem to me as if he's ever looked at the drawings, but I digress. And over the period of Archigram, we each pursued a series of different ideas. I'm not going to track over that very much. It's extremely highly documented. I think the seventh Archigram book is being done by somebody right now, and you can go and see what they all think about it. A typical irony, though, is this drawing, which was drawn when I was on my first American gig, which was a long one. It was being brought over to the faculty at UCLA, together with Ron Heron and Dorota Izazaki. In fact, the three of us ran a class together, which was amazing. And I sat in the apartment drawing this drawing, which purported to be a reflection of what you could do with an English field if you brought all sorts of weird shit into it and made a city in a field for a week. The irony is, of course, I was sitting in Los Angeles doing this, and in retrospect, I ponder upon what parts of the drawing, it's only half the drawing here, what parts of the drawing were influenced by a sort of sideways glance down the hill from Westwood Village into the tiki-taki, which was much more extant then in L.A., and to what extent it was an Englishman bringing his ideas to another place. In other words, was it coloured by the present moment, or had I been carrying it all in my head? And I think that reflection continues now, where I'm most happy on the West Coast, particularly L.A., which I'm very familiar with, your town less, and particularly in Japan. And I feel that both of those places have certain resonances for which almost all the members of Archigram have responded at different times. I've done a sort of trick over the years, which I call the one-month rule. The one-month rule is where I find myself either once or repeatedly in a town, get to know the town a bit, get to know some of the people in the town, and then I think, I would like to respond to this town by designing something for it. The irony, of course, again, is that nobody actually asks you or pays you to do this. You simply do it as a sort of arrogant response to a non-asked question. But one of the towns that I've been most familiar with is Oslo in Norway. And this is an old scheme where I make a commentary upon the condition of Nordic cities, which is that they have a lot of long, dark evenings. And there's a particular feature of them that I like, which is a kind of lanterns that you get that were developed usually around the 1920s or thereabouts, large lanterns that you get at sort of fascia level along the streets. They have cheap electricity, of course. And I got off on this, and I thought, wouldn't it be marvelous if there was a housing tower, which had lanterns on it, and that the lantern in my addled brain linked to the idea of the bay window. And the bay window then linked in my addled brain to the idea of the apartment that could be like a lantern. So as you move up the tower, the lanterns go from the street lantern scale bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger up into the sky. And in the daytime, the buildings are colored, but the coloration is a very deliberate coloration, which is that which is favored by a lot of the Norwegian functionalist architects of the 20s and 30s, who borrowed, in fact, from painters, who, in fact, borrowed then from the colors of the plateau in the middle of Norway, the flower colors. And so these pastel colors are actually local. So in a sense, I would claim for the project that it was extremely site-specific, and that it got its inspiration from that. I have been to many other places. My wife comes from Tel Aviv, and I've been able to observe the psychology of Tel Aviv, about which much can be said. And I've also spent quite a lot of time in Australia now, and once when I did these two towers in the 80s, and then more recently, as you'll discover. And the Brisbane Tower is, in fact, a combination of two towers. One, a sort of the air-conditioned pencil tower, which I think was an early version of one which looks rather similar to those that you may know, that were built. And the other one is really a pile of English bungalows, those metal bungalows that you get in Brisbane that were imported initially from the UK and put up on stilts with a sort of cheap way of having cross ventilation and getting your feet out of the bug-ridden swamp. And so I thought, why not have a housing tower, which is in effect a series of these bungalows, one on top of the other. The Tel Avivian one is more to do with dealing with the sunshine and also getting your legs out of the town for various reasons. I'm amused to add in the people in the middle. And it is for you to guess which of them are from Tel Aviv and which of them are from Brisbane. And in fact, some of them are possibly interchangeable because both of those towns have a certain attitude to life. And bronzed ladies and jolly fisherman-like people can be seen in either town. So I won't tell you which are taken from which. I have almost broken the rules in the case of Sao Paulo. I have been there about five times. I'm not sure that it adds up to a month, but I'm fascinated by it. And as you will remember, I was fascinated by Burleigh Marx as a deep provincial student, wondering what this was all about. What was this all this wobbly stuff? And it was Brazil. And Brazil had an amazing cachet to a 1950s provincial English architect. You couldn't imagine even what Brazil might remotely be like. I was just lucky enough to meet Burleigh Marx before he died, and it was every bit as good as I'd imagined it was going to be. But, and so my tower is a sort of homage to the idea of the Brazilian building, albeit that the photograph that I've simply downloaded off the internet suggests that, which is, I think, so, that Sao Paulo is actually a much more hard-headed, tough, almost Germanic place. It makes the money for all the rest of Brazil to sit in the sun, basically. And I think that perhaps if I were to redo that particular tower, I would take that into consideration. The other one with the question mark, I will leave for the moment and return to later. And I was invited once with a lot of other people to take part in a show in Paris. We were all asked to do towers or buildings for Paris, and I chose to do mine as a kind of Englishman's incursion into that rivalry city of saying, I will do a tower of housing, but it will only just sit into the River Seine. It sort of puts its foot half in the water and half out of it. So we'll be very discreet. And we'll have a garden in it, which is rather like a sort of vertical English garden. And it will have rotating apartments so that when the blooms in the Bois de Boulogne are marvelous, you rotate the apartment. And if the couple in the adjoining apartment having a row, you also have the option of rotating it. Or if you just get bored, you can rotate it. Which leads me to a preoccupation around which I'm still frustrated. In middle age and later life, I started to build. I surprised everybody who would have written me off as a drawer or a talker or a teacher when in a few years ago I started getting the odd building built. And then they're kind of very puzzled. They've got you pigeon. You know, it's very convenient. In fact, it's extremely convenient for a lot of people to say, "Ah, yes, they sort of draw, and they sort of write books, and they teach, and that's all right. They won't really interfere with things," and you're neatly pigeonholed. And then suddenly you start doing a building, and it doesn't particularly leak, and people do quite like, and it does quite well. And they say, "Oh, because that upsets things. You're not meant to come out of your cupboard." But one of the things that hasn't come out in that period so far is the making of a vegetated building. I've been banging on about it. I've been drawing it. I've been showing it. I've been photographing it. But so far, we haven't actually pulled one off yet. We haven't actually vegetated anything, though we would like. But here's a thing, and I think that it's wonderful that you have Mark here, because I have a great admiration for the enthusiasm of the Germans, particularly when they're your students. Funny things happen to them later, but they're amongst the best students to ever have, and Yel and I, who have both taught German students and others, were saying to you that any group in London or elsewhere, if it's got a couple of Germans in the group, it's going to move. They'll be the people who know what's written in books and so on. Anyhow, one of the things that happens to you is that you do lectures, and this is by no means the first lecture I've ever given. So you do a lecture somewhere, and then somebody comes up to you at the end and they say, there's something like your thing just down the road, you see. And this happened particularly at one time in Germany. They said, it's in Karlsruhe, it's this thing, you must see. And indeed, there is, and it's one of my favorites because it's exactly something that one was talking about. So the idea that you could have an armature, you could have a kind of structure, and it could vegetate over in the summer and become a room. Now, there were some dreary people who said, can't possibly be, it must have been glazed at one time. But no, I have seen the original drawing. It was never intended to be glazed. It was intended to be a growy. Good one. The other one is Schwetzingen. They said, it must come to Schwetzingen. Exactly your kind of thing. And indeed, it is though done, I think, by Italian gardeners in the 18th century. So one of my responses later was to do a veg house, a vegetated house. A simple triangular space with a power plant at the top end, car parking on the left, a bit of a cliff, a skin enclosing it, and the yellow triangle basically being the roof enclosure. Watch the top right-hand side. Now, this is a project that metamorphoses. You'll notice that there are a few little armatures with bits of plantation on them. So that's nice, very sweet, very nice to have. In the next stage, I can't quite say what the time interval would be, but a bit of a time interval, and the plantation is growing away onto those bits of trellis. And the position of the bed has moved. The kitchen's even got its apparatus being sort of almost threatened by the vegetation. And we move on in time. Now there are glades and thickets and vines growing, and a particular favourite of mine, because I'm a bit of a hi-fi nut, that you could have vegetation with sort of hidden hi-fi conditions and furniture that you're not quite sure about it till you sit on it, whether it's fish flesh or fowl or plant. And time moves on, and things get very, very exotic, and I start to do something that I'd done years before that in the Archigram drawings, which is to write ideas on the drawing. So the idea of the glade, which is a very evocative term, or sloping and folding and weaving. And it moves on. It gets crazier, gets really weird. And this is a situation where, and I've done it on about four or five projects over the years, where I set in my head the trajectory. But I don't quite know how far it will go, and I can only really look about one drawing ahead of the one I'm doing. And then it's almost as if the drawing takes over. It's not really the drawing taking over, it's your brain starting to go into strange, frightening crevices. And the last version is so crazy, I just say, shit, I'll stop. But if you have a veg house, you should have a veg village. Here the yellow enclosures are different shaped, they're not all triangular. There are all sorts of suppurating pieces of territory. There are hydroponically grown vegetables, there are rivulets, there are paths, there are weird kind of overlays. And this thing would coagulate and move and change like a kind of constantly moving collage. And in fact, one of my favorite conditions is the marshland, the marsh it's just a coincidence that Gavin Rowbottom, with whom I work, comes from about a mile away from that picture on the left and is a child of the marshland. And what I find interesting about the marsh is that it is both solid and not solid. It is territory, but not territory. It is as found ambiguity. And I think the veg village is almost exactly an extrapolation of the idea of the marshland. But then one has done other metamorphic projects. This is a favorite from the 80s called Way Out West. Now, I have to fill in a bit of the background of that, which is that I had, by that time, visited Berlin several times to exhibit and to do a few other things. I can't quite remember at that time. I hadn't built but at that point, but I had been there a number of times, and I was fascinated by it, as I always am, by reading about the Berlin of the 1930s, reading about Ischewood's Berlin and the Berlin of the bittersweet atmosphere and the underworld that it must have had. And here I was also interested in taking a site which was at the western end of what was still just at that moment West Berlin. The great street of West Berlin being the Kurfürstendamm. But what is fascinating about this wonderful street is that it just sort of peters out at the end. You go to the end of it and there's sort of nothing there. Like, wouldn't it be marvelous if there was a something? But the something turns out to be then a parody of Americana, of an American city. I put an American grid because it's west, and at that time it was being financially supported by America. And so it was west to west. But then I said, it won't be the real west. It will be the west of the city. It will be the way out west. It will be the Arizonan west with the cactus. So the cactus became a generating form for some of the architecture. And as you notice, between an early stage of this street corner and the later stage on the right, the cactus takes over the architecture. There's some more examples, and you can see from the four layout plans there, going 1, 2, 3, 4, that the grid is eventually taken over by the cactus condition. There's another spooky element of this, which is the notion that the little tiny island in the middle of the lake is also acting as some kind of trigger for the dynamic of the vegetation. So it's a very spooky, funny, spooky project, and leads to all kinds of juxtapositions taken from the memory or from, again, rather like the veg house, where does it end? It goes further and further into a kind of strange mulch. Much, much more recently, this is a drawing that I made to look again at the possibilities of vegetal structure and their ambiguity vis-a-vis architectural structure. In other words, I draw an imagined vegetation. But you can see that some of the elements are actually quite formalized. They surely must be man-made. The sort of blue log jam, for example. And then if you look closely at some of the other elements, you see that perhaps they might be tectonic. They might be glass. There might be objects in there. And in fact, if you then start looking at more of the drawing, you find they very definitely are. So I'm sort of playing with myself, saying how far can apparently random or only drifting structure of vegetation imply tectonic organization? How loosely can tectonic organization lose itself or be analogous with the natural forms? Gavin and I did a project for one of the biennales in Venice, and then later came back looking at it, and with one of the rather clever digital people in our office, then looked at what would happen if London flooded, with global warming, if we completely ran out of resources and all we were left with odd bits of leftover and driftwood and strange things. And what could happen if we then built these megastructures up which you would survive until the flood got to you? The sort of Armageddon-like condition. Though it has already, as you will notice, certain preferred themes, such as the growing veg. We're able to extend this together with somebody who you will remember, Salvador, on a project which actually won its competition, but that was right at the moment when the economy collapsed in Spain, and it never happened. But we were engaged in this real project for making a ecologically friendly tower with as much natural ventilation and cooling as possible, but boosted by computer-aided systems for the south of Spain, for Murcia, in fact. Returning to Berlin, though, I return then to another sort of subplot, which is a predilection for blue, building. And the first blue building was built in Berlin. So some years after the Way Out West, one actually, I did a film for German television, and Joseph Kleihus, who was in charge of a thing called the Bauausstellung, said, "Oh, if you're so clever as to criticize our projects, you do one as well." So we got this commission to do a very small piece of social housing, which is in effect a blue building, which in effect designs itself, a very easy building to design because the west faces the park and the Tiergarten and has the double height spaces. So when the sun comes down and the family gathers, in theory, they go into the winter garden, there is a double height space. And on the east, which is the courtyard side, you have smaller windows, the bathrooms, the sun wakes you up in the morning. It designs itself. And there then is blue building number 3, which is in Madrid. And blue building number 4, which is just on site now in England, to which I will return. Because blue building number 2, in case you didn't know, is probably the most famous one, which is the Blob, or the Kunsthaus Graz, which we won in a competition. And it's interesting that the English press, this is a page from the Guardian newspaper, talking about the attack of the blobs. And here are some German publication, the große Blob, again, the same word. And I was even amused that in Frankfurt at that time, somebody did a conference called Blobmeister. Now, I love this. I love this in cultural terms, because there is blob, which I think is very English.
Blob.
And Meister, das ist der Meister da. The Blob Meister. I love it. I love things like that. Now, in fact, in our country, we have a very legitimate history of the blob. We have that most marvelous 19th century blob, terrific blob building, and we have the television personality,
Mr. Blobby.
I also take this opportunity to say that the building has been something of a success and appears on postage stamps, chocolate bars, T-shirts, posters for Austria, hats, etc. And it's being looked after very well. Well, if you go down an unsuspecting street in Graz, and this is a sort of back street, you're just walking, you know, perhaps you might be walking nonchalantly along, suddenly there's a bum hanging out of the side of the place, you see. And in fact, we like to think of this as a rather friendly animal. He sits very comfortably in the city of Graz, comfortably in his basket. And if you didn't realize, if you look at the top of those Baroque churches, there was a blob architecture existing, albeit in bits. It wasn't a new, it wasn't. Graz is a much tougher old bird than people give it credit for. The building is very simple, and when I saw all the 100 and whatever number of competition entries that there were, I realize that most of them are more complicated than our one. They did all sorts of things sticking out all the place doing this. And ours is just a blob and a pin and a skin. We had something of the advantage that we both, Colin Fournier and I, knew the town rather well. He knew it particularly well. And I had been there about 8 times. And in fact, I knew the site for the very particular reason that with groups of Bartlett students, it had a bar which was open at 3 o'clock in the morning on that site. And that so you know the site. And I think you can be more radical if you know a site. You can say, well, nah, it says in the book you should do that. Of course you don't have to. And the organization of the building is such that there was, if you look at the left and the top, an existing pair of buildings. The left-hand building, in fact, had to be reconstructed, but was very important. I'll tell you why in a moment. And the top was some old sort of third-rate Baroque shops. And then we had this sort of shape to fill in. And all we did was to, in this version of the project, we simply came along and kind of squirted ketchup, like going into the available space. And that is the shape of your building, you see. And then you put the pin in that gets you from the... Because we knew the site, we said, there's an obvious place where you come in. Don't just piss about. That's where you come in. Straight up. Go straight up there. And then the pin returns and the spur. The left-hand building is a reconstruction of an old building and is called the it's called the Eisner's House, the Iron House, because it was the first cast-iron building south of the Alps or in that part of Austria or something. And one of the things I think that has struck me after it was how that some of the spaces that you never predicted turned out to be the best spaces. So what happens? People come in and either you go down and sit in the cafe or you just disappear up a travelator. And here are some typical Austrian bourgeoisie. I like the Austrian bourgeoisie. They always have white wine in their hand. And it's very elegant. And I think, let's stick them up a fucking escalator. You know. travelator. You know, and they're very pompous. I mean, they don't really go to look at the art. They go to meet people. Oh, they're extremely polite. They still bow to their royal family, and they're not meant to have one. You know, things like that. But the other thing is the thing of going up into the unknown, which is actually a re-quotation of something we did as an exhibition in Archigram years before. But so here you get these sort of people going up the travel aid. I will now name drop to the extent that I had the pleasure of accompanying the Chancellor of Austria himself with a glass of white wine in my hand and a glass of white wine in his hand, having a discussion about nothing as one went up this normal travel aid that you get in airports and railway stations and sort of, okay, so much for the pomp and ceremony. I quite like that. I have a love-hate relationship with the Austrians. They're picky people, but I'm amused by their old-fashionedness. Anyway, I digress. Lots of rather good artists have come and done installations and enjoyed it. A lot of bad artists say it hasn't got any square rooms in it. Now, here is the metal building on the left, this early 19th century building, which we had to preserve because this is part of Austrian culture. In fact, we spent millions of euros propping up this bloody thing and putting the Camera Austria organization into it. And then we discovered that the pieces had come from Sheffield, England. In other words, a load of balmy English people had sold the Austrians some metal stuff in the 19th century, and some balmy English had come and sold the Austrians some plastic stuff at the end of the 20th century. And I like that. I think it's a screw culture, you know, screw tradition, screw the vernacular. Everything's a vernacular once you've done it, right? Seriously, you know. I can say that because I come from a place that has Roman ruins, which are rubbish when you go and see them. and Gothic churches, which mostly look like each other, except the good ones, which are probably fakes anyhow. And that Norwich Castle I showed you was a rebuild, was a 19th century rebuild. It's a crummy, crusty old thing inside, but they wanted to make it look like a proper castle. So they put a sort of suit on it that looks like... You know, there's a lot of wanking going on in Europe about culture and stuff. But to be serious for 5 seconds, that, you know, the easy thing for the journalists to say was, an Archigram building has been done at last. Actually, it might be, it might not be, but it could not have been done in the period because we didn't have computers that could run it up. So, I mean, it needed the development of Rhino, in fact, for the nozzles to be landed as quickly and efficiently as they were. And here they are. Most of the nozzles face north because you're trying to pull in north light, except for the naughty nozzle. There's one nozzle he doesn't. He faces the castle. It's another requotation of an old Archigram trick where Mike Webb had done a periscope that stuck outside the envelope of the project into the street, and people queued up to look at London buses, and then to ride by a bus. And here, they queue up to look at the castle, even though you have to be blind not to notice the castle in the middle of town on top of a mountain. And I think there are other aspects of the building that I have to admit to, which was a fascination which I had had since a student with Chernikov's fantasies and with some of the Russian constructivist work. And I think the piece that made me most happy when I saw it really being constructed, not so much the blob, because we'd had lots of bother with the blob and lots of conversation about it, and all the worries that people had till we did the mock-up was about the blob. You know, this was the tricky one. But the cantilevered part, that's what I'd always dreamt of doing, something that shot out into space. And I smile. I think you remember, I had a real smile when I saw it starting to come, to cantilever out into space. And in the end, one has to admit of it, that it is a craft building. The bits are put together just as the building next to it, just as the tiled roof is a craft building with bits and pieces stuck together. It's not high tech, it's crap tech. You know, we didn't have the money for high tech. And it is simply constructed with a concrete frame up to second floor, then steel frame, a lot of insulation, and the skin, the final skin, is really a kind of coating. The water comes through the gaps of that skin onto the steel skin, which is actually the one that keeps the water out. But as I said earlier, some of the most, for me, engaging aspects are when I see the interstitial spaces that have occurred that you didn't even predict on the models or the drawings. Somehow there's some amazing things that happen between the parts of the project. And there are other things that Colin and I were very keen to demonstrate, the notion of a melting skin, the fact that you could have openings where you go from transparent to translucent to solid and back again. That was something that we've given more time and more money, we would have done more of. And then, as light falls, you have the 920 pixels with 100 degrees of light possibility. We had this marvelous group from Berlin who helped us do this. And you can play movies on it. You can advertise on it. You quite, as has happened many times already, competitions or groups of artists or designers come to program it. And the thing I like about it, and one sees now many, many pixelated facades, particularly in Asia, is that it's really more like body art. It rides the body. It isn't in a sort of four-square frame. It rides the body. It lives with the body of the building. Another competition that we won, but didn't build because it's Italy, was in by Lake Maggiore. It's a town theatre. And again, I'm amused by little towns, and one imagines a kind of theatre that they, you know, they'd have some sort of third-rate dance company or second-rate people up from Turin or something. But what it really acts as is a focus for the town. Again, the Italian version of the crook finger, maybe a more lusty red, and a bit more cigarette and a bit more chat. And the theatre really is a focus for the town. It's a town that has a tradition of clay, of terracotta. And we tried to make the building a terracotta building. We made it so that the parts of the building fit, again, into the scale of the town. And there is a tradition, I think, in Italian and Spanish towns of just ad hoc things happening on the terrace. You know, somebody just playing or singing or whatever, and a few drinks and what the hell. And one wanted the building to have that quality, and because it adjoins the marketplace, we made it so that you could use the steps, and you'd have films running from the steps, and you'd have the bar tucked in the side of the market, and the hope that, okay, sometimes people would come into the auditorium and sit in a tiff-up sleep seat and then probably go to sleep. But actually, the lifeblood of the small-town theatre is in its facilities around itself. And that was what we featured. And we were lucky in winning the competition, as I say, even if they didn't build it. And it's still one of our favorite projects. We've done a lot of tower projects in Taiwan. They had a series of competitions, some of which we were more successful in than others. And I find that in the first version, the first of our Taiwan towers, there is an analogy with a very old tower that I did way back when, one of the earliest projects I'd done, which is in the sense that the tower becomes an armature upon which other things then hang or attach, rather like a giant kind of coat stand. The notion of the tower as a coat stand, you apply things to it and hang them off it. And that notion has lasted for a long time. The first Taiwan Tower was inspired by the idea of developing fuel from algae, and in some way, in some romantic way, hanging the fuel and the algae off in great sacks. They quite liked it, and we proceeded to the next stage, where we then looked at the algae growing slightly more seriously. And then to another stage, where we allied the algae growing to other forms of energy gaining, wind energy, solar energy, and so on. And we formed these energy packs into kind of blades that flaked their way down the armature and over the top of the park. The armature is a carrier for a number of sub-buildings. Some are things like wedding halls, laboratories, offices and museums and so on, which tuck themselves into and hang off the tower, but always, in a way, cloaked by these blades. Another area where we've applied colour is in a series of competitions. This was a competition for a railway station in Birmingham, a grubby town that does have a bit of colour if you know how to look for it, and we organized our building, which is meant to skin the railway station, by using colors as you moved around the site that would reflect back to predominant coloration, so that a terracotta street is reflected back to the red part, and future systems' marvelous blue building is reflected by the blue, and so on. We didn't win the competition. Foreign Office won it, and are doing, I think, a white building. In Taiwan, we had a site for a music strip. The idea of the competition was a series of music boxes, places where they rehearse and have performances, mostly pop music. And here, I played a rather more complicated game. I was interested in form changing as you went down. It's a very long site, about a third of a kilometre or more, and I was interested in the form changing from one end of the site, and in the foreground, the blue end, we see is at the city end. And so the formal architecture is very stiff, very distill-like at that end, but very coloured. And then as you move down and as these various boxes proliferate, the colour decreases, but the form increases. So if you look from the other end, you have a very much more wild pavilions, but almost monochrome. And so one was playing a sort of urban game of two things metamorphosing, the one in one sense and the other in another. And I'm still interested in the idea. Rather than saying it will all be of a certain formality, it will all be of a certain kind of palette, of actually switching along a line. You can, it's sort of thing you can do along a long building. And so there have been many, many projects where I've looked at the mixture, the collaging almost, of different formal and sculptural and colour conditions, including vegetation as one constituent. And then we won another competition, and this one has got built. In fact, there are six buildings simultaneously completed, one by Zaha, one by... Comepinos, one by Eduardo Arroyo, one by Bus Architects, one by... God, I've forgotten his name, Japanese, in L.A. thing. Anyway... And ours is a very large building. So suddenly, we had a 200-meter-long pair of buildings. And it caused quite a flummox to our little office, which had to suddenly upscale and deal with this. And it is a coloured building, as you will notice. And I did one or two cartoons, which didn't seem to lose us the competition. I thought, well, Vienna, by which time I knew Vienna very well, having used it to travel to Graz and to do exhibitions and teaching and all sorts of funny things. And I thought, isn't it a pity that university buildings, in so many university buildings in Europe, sort of go dead at about 5 o'clock in the evening? Why can't Vienna be held, if it's a good enough place, why can't they hang on in there? And so you get people doing all sorts of very, very naughty things if you look carefully. As they might do in a proper Viennese building. And it didn't seem to put off the jury. And another thing that largely developed by Gavin was the notion of these what we call sunshine corners. By squeezing the plan, we created some internal spaces that were really where this kind of thing went on, and some external conditions where the sun could get into the crevices of the building, the nooks and crannies. And here, indeed, are the pair of buildings with the sunshine corners and the nooks and crannies. And the colour system, where the darker colours are closer to the ground and the lighter colours are nearer the sky, but where the carpeting of the common spaces runs in reverse. So again, it's that reverse thing, where at the lighter part of the building you have the darker carpeting, that the darker part of the building, you have the lighter carpeting. Of course, they cross somewhere in the middle. And in fact, of course, years before, I had been interested in the notion of the striations of colour around a building. And Jan and I found ourselves, during the court, whilst this building was being constructed, in Valparaiso in Chile. And there, somebody had been doing it. And again, you know, you have to have this attitude. If somebody says down the road or over in Chile, there's something like your thing. There are two ways that you can respond to this. Either you can say, oh, you know, my life has been useless. What is it? Somebody's done it in the 18th century, or they've done it there. Or you say, great, great idea, isn't it? Yeah, wow, go for it. Which you can only do The entry to, between the two buildings is of smiling corners. I always say it's sort of smiling faces as you come in between the administration building on the right and the law school, which is our main building on the left. It's a complex plan, and when you see this, which is sort of not quite a working drawing, but towards a working drawing, you see that it was quite a monster to sort out beyond just nice chirpy corners and so on. And we then put this kind of beard, we put this kind of fashionable stubble over it, which is partly to do with sunshading and partly to do with making a link to the forest which runs alongside, because this is built right by the Prater Gardens, which were the Habsburgs' hunting grounds, and still have a lot of trees in them. And rather than having just having a kind of hard building, not only do we make it a coloured building, we make it a friendly, slightly creepy, funny building, which the local architects hate, and all the users love. We got the award as the most loved building by the people who work there, and probably the most hated building by the Viennese architects. And we have these internal spaces which modulate. I don't see any people in the bottom one, which say, oh, I ought to draw in some of my naughty people just to prove it. And in the library, we have a series of cabins which are where you can be noisy and private and gossip about things. And then a series of kind of terraces underneath the actual terraces of the open space. And then we have some quite interesting corner conditions and the sunshine corners, in fact. There they are, and they live, and they're sunny, and they do bring the sun right into the building. This is a rather exaggerated photo where you see that there are also some roof lights, not like the Graz ones. You can actually sit on these roof lights. So as you're sitting in one of these little capsules, you're discussing higher matters of law with your friend, you might see somebody's bum sitting on your top, if you're lucky. And at night, I think it works rather well. It's a very friendly building. As I say, the users seem to love it. And it incorporates a whole lot of preoccupations about rolling the plan. I think, if I can give a giveaway, my favorite way of designing is to use a fountain pen. And the ink moves so it almost glides. And I enjoy the arm movement of the glide. I enjoy buildings that glide. I'm not really into sharp cornered buildings. I like the glide. I like the notion of the glide. And I think this comes through. Sometimes one has silly ideas. I was asked by Marcos Cruz, I think it was, to do a drawing for an issue of AD that he was doing. And I thought, I'll draw a preoccupation of mine. For a long time, I thought, why don't we have comfortable, vegetated, high-tech clubs? A compo-veg club was my notion. And this is the drawing. And then the kind people at SIARC asked me to do an installation. And it was, in fact, a development of the Compo Veg Club. Not quite as complicated, because we had to do it cheap. And we virtually did it ourselves. And there is the Compo Veg Club as reinterpreted in SIARC. And it's very comfortable. And you can see, and in fact, it was so comfortable that it was reported to me that late at night, very naughty things happened on it. And much of it has disappeared into people's apartments in the area. And then I did something which I'd never been able to do before, which is to take the Compo Veg constructed version and insert it into a rerun of what the Compo Veg Club might be. So I had the early version, the simplified, if you like, constructible version, and then rolling that back. And it's very nice to take a scheme and then roll it back into the idea stage. I've been preoccupied by a lot of other ideas. The idea of the boardwalk. I come from the seaside, and I'm fascinated by the promenades that you get in European seaside resorts and the boardwalk that you get in American condition. And I'm fascinated by the idea of a small place, which this is a outriding town of Madrid called Pinto, where, again, with Salvador Arroyo, I did a project where we had this master plan, and this is the sort of central area of the project, which would be the meeting place of the small town with the boardwalk, and the notion of the flaneur who would parade around from the skateboard and the cyclists and people sitting maybe with cigarettes, dare I say, and girls looking at guys and guys looking at girls and somebody selling them something out of a kiosk, a kind of casual rolling place. And the model suggests that the buildings would be up on legs with the kiosks tucking themselves under as constituent elements, and that the markets and so on would be a product of that. And in fact, a predilection for noses, because I realize that I have a liking for noses, that both in the Vienna building, the noses come together, and in the Graz building, the nose sticks itself out. And here, in this project, there are noses again. The third blue building is also in Madrid and happened a little bit after that project and was actually a commission from the city to do some social housing, again, in connection with Salvador. And this is the blue building, lifted on legs so that the kiosks could sit underneath it. The notion was that we wouldn't design the kiosks. They would be done by crappy old kiosk makers, as they should be. And that the top of the building would have sports facilities. So it was life above the housing and below it. So the housing would be a kind of sandwich. And then very, very elegant system of shuttering. What happened was that it started building the three floors of car parking, the first two or three floors of concrete, and then it stopped. It stopped for nearly 2 years because they went bankrupt. That was Spain. And then they found a builder who would complete it. And it is complete, but no sports. So far, no kiosks. And the blue is a bit less blue than we wanted. And no shutters. And that raises a very scary issue, because there are 100 families in there in quite nice apartments, and you can park the car, and it is what it is. And it raises the issue, to what extent? I'm sad because I think the sports facilities and the kiosks and the shutters were a major part of the scheme. But the building is there, and the families live in it. And the staircase is probably in the right place, and the kitchens work. So it works. So you're left in this very odd condition where you know it's not right, and that the elements that you're lacking are, if you like, superficial elements, but key to the fulfillment of the project. And so you're left with a piece of raw, almost modernist work. One of my preoccupations is coming back over that last bit, is with kiosks. I irritate everybody by it. Some lectures I give have loads and loads and loads and loads of kiosks. This is a one-slide digest of the kiosks. And you can see we get around, and I'm fascinated by the way in which the kiosks give away the psychology of the different places. If you take a kiosk in Pristina, it's very different from a kiosk in Skopje, though they're only about 100 miles apart. The whole psychology is different. The whole arrogance of the one to the other is different, and so on and so on. If you take a hamburger kiosk in Malmö, it's different from the hamburger kiosk in Copenhagen, because Malmö and Copenhagen, they're very near, now the bridge, 20 minutes away. Nonetheless, the psychology of the two cities is different. The pitch is different. The tradition of elegance is different. But I digress. And then we were caught by our own petard, because we were invited to do a kiosk in Taipei. It was a sort of demo. And this kiosk is actually sitting there, hopefully being jolly. And then I come to another competition project that we did way back now in 2008, which was for a footbridge in Skopje. And we're completely daft. We sometimes do these competitions knowing there is no chance that we will win. They wanted a concrete footbridge, right? Not very big river, concrete footbridge. And then I said, wouldn't it be interesting if we put a kiosk on the bridge? And Gavin said, hey, wouldn't it be interesting if we made the kiosk move? And I said, hey, wouldn't it be interesting if we put a bar on the top of the moving kiosk where the legs drop down at 6 o'clock, and you could still, kid could still buy a choc ice underneath, and, you know, somebody's sitting there with a glass of sliver of it. And that was our project. And we love it. And I was once talking about this in a lecture in of all places, Tokyo. And a voice at the back of the hall said, they built a concrete one. And it was some guy from Skopje who found himself in the audience that day. And of course they built a concrete one. We knew they were going to build a concrete one. But nonetheless, once you get whipped up with the idea and you bounce it back and it gets more and more. Now, I show this still, 2008 project, I still show it in every lecture. I live with a forlorn hope that somebody somewhere has a bit of a river or a piece of parkland or suddenly thought of having a bar on top of a chalk ice stand or any part of the project. Well, now we come to the other competition win that started later than the Vienna building but actually ended up almost similar. So we suddenly had, from almost nothing, two quite substantial buildings finishing almost in parallel, quite weird. And here's the rub, because this one was for an architecture school. And there it is, sitting in Bond University campus, which is in a town, very weird town, called Gold Coast, which probably none of you have heard of. Gold Coast is already 4/5 the size of San Francisco, at least the municipality. And it's the 6th largest town in Australia, and the fastest growing. But it's a sort of funny place, a bit like Florida, where they drive Toyotas, you know, as somebody once described it. Very funny, full of lagoons and retirees, and very strange place. Anyhow, they have this university, and we won the competition, and it is for an architecture school. Now, here is the rub. If, as you correctly stated, in my deep past, I'd been the director of the ICA. That was slightly useful when doing the Graz building, because you knew what it was like to be the other side of the table, as it were. And you knew there were certain things you could do in a different way than it says in the book. Now, I've been much more involved in architecture schools. And suddenly, you are poacher-turned-gamekeeper. You're landed with doing the thing. And it is full of conversations. Having nosed around architecture schools for so long, it is a combination of anecdotal information, and my partner, Gavin, has also studied and taught in a number of different schools. And therefore, we have many, many anecdotes that we can throw. We say, you know that funny sort of corridor they've got at UCLA where you look down on it? It's not bad. You know the roof in Harvard where it does this? That's not bad. You know the basement that used to be in the Bartlett? That's not bad. And that's not a bad idea, is it? Hey, that one's awful. But that one, that's not quite a nice idea. And if you come in, And of course it is a whole series of memories and observations. And then the gang said to me in the competition stage, why don't you do some of your cartoons? And I was, this is a favorite amongst the group, where it's a typical situation where a bunch of rather pompous young faculty being clever, and said, one thing, I can't do the American accent, the English version is, I question your terms of reference, Barbara. And there's poor Barbara there, standing with a piece of paper quivering, and her friend Joe is trying to put up his drawing and think it's not, it's getting to him. And Charlie, the guy who's done a very typically Bartlett situation, which is some sort of electronic thing that worked last Friday, and is highly unlikely to work at the jury, but then you do the jury and it's not working and you're just going off for a drink or something and suddenly rushes up, we've got it working now, come back. Anyhow, you know this kind of scene. And of course life imitates art, because here is a PSYOP jury with indeed Barbara and her sheaf of notes and some fairly smarty-pants young faculty trying to be... The thing I notice in American juries is how the faculty don't really look at the projects, but like to position themselves so that they might get tenure. And then the other thing is life imitating art. Here was a sketch I did for the competition where this poor hopeless creature thinks he might pull the bird on the other... But you look at him, he stands very little chance with her, really. But it gets him in late at night. And then I managed to photograph in the actual building a dark-haired girl sitting almost exactly in the spot of the cartoon. All the fact that you would encourage people to work there all the time, and it being Australia, because there's a bottle of wine or two rolling around. And... friends disappearing down the staircase, or that there would be selective use of colour. And that the building, and I think this is one of the reasons it won the competition, it was read by some of the university people on the committee as being the sort of building that at last they would have a decent public space, because we have a street that goes down the core of the building. And there is life imitating art again. And I was also trying to flatter Bond University by suggesting that there might be the odd person passing by from who's going to be back at Princeton next Wednesday. And you see the significance of the street. The street is really the core of the whole project. We are in Queensland, which is warm and bright and can get a bit steamy. And the key thing is to keep the sun out, but to bring the air through. Another favorite condition of mine, speaking from the other side of the desk, is the idea of escape. I've always felt wherever I've worked, particularly if you're at the top end of the institution, that you need to be able to escape. You need some way of seeing something extremely boring coming in your direction, being able to exit. And of course, it's in a beach town, the likelihood is that Jules was spending, you know, there is a suburb of this town called Surface Paradise. You get the general picture, it has an amazing beach. And he probably hasn't been in the building for a month. And so it's nice to see you in the building, Jules. And then the other member of faculty is trying to do a diver. He doesn't want to get involved in the conversation, so you need to give him a piece of circulation by which he can escape a possibly tiresome conversation. Or here is my favorite life-imitating art, because I'm purporting that there would be conditions where, again, extremely pompous academic would be going on about, you know, accepting points of departure. And there's a poor old guy sitting in the front who's mortgaged his house to come as a postgraduate student, thinking, what a load of shit this is. But it's too late to back out. And then somebody photographed me with the same gesture as the boring guy, you see. And the fact that you can look down, you can have circulation, by which you can observe things going on without necessarily interfering with them, which I think is also important. And I notice you have it sort of here. And all sorts of other layers of architecture school life. Now, there is a serious organization to this. There is the core and the north side, which of course is the hot side in Australia, and the south side, which is the cool side, and the south side also looks out onto the open space. In the competition, we had, I think, 5 bays of scoop and a long nose again. In the built version, we had to lose 1 bay and solidify slightly, but very largely kept the same organization. And the building was built quite quickly. I think it was built about only 2.25 years after the competition. So it moved fast. And you will notice these U-shaped pieces, which are the scoops. And they're very much, I think they're very much Gavin's child, the notion of the scoop. But they also relate to the Vienna building in the sense of pulling in and having these sort of enclosures in the interior of the building where non-curriculum things would go on. So they are, if you notice, each one slightly different shape, but they also are the primary structure of the building. They hold the roof and they define the territories of the studios. And then there are a series of insertions which deal with cupboards and access and so on. And then there is the entrance condition, which sits out rather like the Madrid building, sits out on legs and opens itself to you. A lot of sketches, particularly Gavin's, who's a good sketcher. And a lot of, as in any building, a lot of tweaking and developing of the precise elements to get them repeatable but not boring. And then a lot of insertions of the technology. And then a basic system, the scoop holding the roof and the stair winding round. And rationalizing the scoop so that the number of pieces of formwork could be reduced, the number of types of formwork. Even so, we still had to import a system from Germany in order to do it. And the local concrete guys were quite nervous before the second pour. After they'd done 2 pours, they got it, it was working, everybody smiled. It's rather similar to what happened with Graz when the first few bits of skin were put on, when they were shown in the Biennale. Until that time, everybody was dead nervous about this bubble. And then they see that it can be done. And everybody relaxes. And in this case, it was the scoops. Everybody wondered how they... As soon as you show it can be done, the whole thing suddenly rolls into another... I guess there are lots of architectural conditions like that. And so we put our best brains on rationalizing the scoops and reducing the number of permutations. And then we have the north facade, which I enjoyed playing with, which is really to say the north has a lot of different window conditions. There are toilets, there are little offices, there are all sorts of funny. Let them just have whatever window they want, and then make it into a kind of art piece by dragging the colour across it, dragging the rainwater pipes across it, and just treat it as a kind of loose artwork. Now, if we trace the progress of the building, at the competition stage, it was quite hard, it was quite heroic, it was almost sort of expressionist, black, tough, deep shadows. A little bit later, there's animated, but still black and dark and basic, though the geometry is the geometry we end up with. Then there's a middle stage where you start looking at some materiality and some possible colours. It goes through a rather sweet, sweet kind of phase here. And then even some of the people visualising the pictures of their girlfriend and shadows and kind of conditions of concrete and spooky periods spooky lighting. Is it really going to be as kind of mysterious as that? Dr. Caligari stuff? And then they start digging the holes. And you cut the crap. The concrete starts going in. What you have are the scoops and the street and the enclosure. And this east-west street is a wonderful kind of barometer of the time of day. It's amazing how the light quality, though we managed to keep the direct sunlight out until the very late part of the afternoon, it has a sculptural and experiential condition. And then the other thing we have is some use of cupboards and closets and so on that are timber, that are plywood. We had the most marvelous local, as it happened, joinery company. Well, they were sort of Peruvian English, but they're sort of local. And you get these amazing conditions of light down the street, percolating through from the studios. So the studio side is a series of trays moving back from the scoops. And we were able to design the furniture as well, which is marvelous to do. We as long as we brought it in under the normal Australian education budget mark, which we did by having it done in China, as one does. And we made nine different pieces of furniture. And here's the studio side, and the lower studio side, where you can see that the configuration can vary very wildly. And then what we call the northern rooms, which are the smaller rooms on the north side, which are the postgraduate rooms, the administration, the toilets, the stack, the fire stairs, the elevator, and so on. And they have their own set of furniture. And then in the nose, in the front of the building, is the helm of the ship, is where the leader of the school sits. The scoops allow views that aren't just straight head-on views, they're sort of percolating views, glimpses. And here is my predilection for noses, both in this building and in Vienna and in Graz. And the furniture even has noses if you look hard. And then there are some strange bits of joinery which fit into the interstitial spaces, with these little cut-out noses. And there it sits with a bit of a forest that was taken away. In fact, we watched them take away trees mechanically. In one day, they took 20 trees out, only in order for the contractor to get his trucks in easily. And now we have a site where you're having to put the trees back again. Anyhow, that sort of thing happened. And an interesting thing, I remember Yael, when we were staying once in a hotel behind Graz, she looked out the window and she said, "You and Colin didn't bother much about that corner, did you?" And being an architect, she was absolutely right that she noticed that we had bothered less with the unloading bay than other aspects of the building. And here is a parallel one where Gavin and I didn't bother much about this end of the building. We just let it sort of happen. I think here it's actually quite successful. It works. But I must admit that it had less design time spent on it. All the generation was on the scoops and the nose and the thing. The north facade, the facade, window. Oh yeah, it just tucks around the back. And it's all right, you know. But you can't bank on that. And being Australia, there's always a sort of a lot of plethora of funny boxes, and they're very health and safety, not that you're not, but they're very health and safety conscious in Australia. everywhere you try and photograph it from, there's some kind of device to stop you doing something naughty. But I think the north facade, I think it works, this sort of random condition where the tailored part of the fenestration then just becomes window where you want window. Let's have a window there. Okay, you need it. Yes, there's a sink underneath. Go, let's do it. And then wobble the facade around it. We did another competition for the same city. We got to the last three out of 70 and lost it to an Australian outfit. But there again, we were looking at scoops for a cultural complex for this weird town. Look at the people of Gold Coast. I don't know, there's a very odd thing if you look at the program of the Queensland Symphony Orchestra, where they're perfectly prepared to play Bruckner in Brisbane, but they only do songs from the shows in Gold Coast, but the same guys are scraping the same violins, which, being a cultural snob, amuses me. And we did a series of scoops that you could hide from the rain, because they'd get quite severe rain there, and you could meet up with people. And then there were more cartoons where we suggested how you could get medium to high culture by stealth. And there are kiosks. And there are a series of large noses, if you like. And Blue 4, which is on site right now, strangely enough, is for my old original college, Bournemouth, which has now gone several notches up in the world and is now its own arts university and has reopened its architecture school, and asked me very kindly a year or so back if I would do a dedicated building for drawing. And so this is a drawing studio in blue, in steel, and this is almost a cartoon. It's some quotations of typical art people that you get in such a place. I could tell a story about each person in the cartoon. And that was an early version when we thought we might make it out of timber. And here is the building on site, and a little sketch I did about Bournemouth being all about pine trees, which it is. And again, we've had to remove some trees. I mean, we seem to go around with moving trees out of the way. Even though I'm somebody who loves vegetation. There's a terrible irony there, I realize. We had to do a lot of sun calculations, and the interior of the building will be very white and plays with four conditions of light. It's a very small building, but it has the north light in the old artist studio tradition. It then has, I don't know, we've got a section that shows it. It has a secondary roof light that will bounce light off the back of the room, which will be a different kind of light, it will be a bounce light. It then has a third light source, which is just a sliver of window that comes underneath a long seat along the side of the room. And then a fourth one, which will be spilt light coming around the porte-clochere, which will gradate. So what I'm doing is also using it as a sort of experiment to see how many kinds of natural light you can control. In the same town, I sometimes do funny schemes. This is, of course, I know it rather more than for a month. I know it for aggregate of about 8 or 9 years. And it's a funny town also. And I suggest silly things for it. And then, finally, the mystery project. I cannot tell you for what town this is. It's not in England. And it's what I think you're all aware of is often as architects we get involved with doing flyers. This has vaguely a client. The client is one removed away. We're playing with the idea. And the idea is a vertical university where the major departments of the university, they have a very tiny site. The idea is to put the elements of the university in three major elements and then have space between them. And the elements of the science and engineering, which goes at the bottom, has the heaviest loaded floors. Law and business in the middle, arts and humanities, and then finally what we call the club and the administration at the top. And the four legs are basically fire escape legs as well as structure. So again, it's rather like the notion of the scoops being the primary structure. These are four extended scoops which hold the three or four buildings. And each entrance condition is different. So you make a pavilion around the foot which has something of the character of the departments that will be above. So the arts and humanities has the most florid entrance, and the sort of belt and braces departments have belt and braces entrances. And the science and engineering department has a different set of requirements, but still sitting within the basic system. And the provost is up the top, but unlikely to be an Anglo-Saxon type of provost. And the club will be somewhere for everybody to relax. Finally, stuff I do which doesn't come under any category. This is a sort of speculative... I do these from time to time, and it's not for any particular place, and I draw it. I start at one end, and it gets to the other end, and I colour it, maybe. But bits of it will crop up later, somewhere. I think the buildable projects are directly related to the non-buildable, non-built. I think there's always a flow through. I've always felt right through my career, there's always a flow through from the purely speculative drawing to the ones that then start to solidify. So here are some references for you to keep sniffing. And we have a website which we update fairly often. And when we're able, if we are ever able to tell you where the vertical university is, or what it turns into, we will put it on the website, of course. And finally, if there's anybody who wants to come and do a month with me at the Bartlett shortly, here's an advertisement. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'm wondering if there are any questions.
Fragen und Antworten.
I guess I won first draft here. So I guess there are some moving parts to this question, and if you feel compelled to grab on to anything. But at the risk of getting some eye rolls, I'm kind of wondering where culture intersects your approach to an intended project. You had said some things about the Blobmeister wanting to kind of stick it to that imperial ethos, or in the Italian project, the surrounding facilities were the lifeblood of theater. And earlier you were talking about in Instant City and in the Paris Gardens, you were referring to the mindset of an Englishman kind of looking into these projects. And so I'm curious where all of those components kind of interrelate. Like, what is it to be an Englishman? Or what is the kind of ethos? You had referenced being brought up in those marshland states, kind of solid but not solid, amongst ruins, provincial childhood. Yes, that's basically in a nutshell. Where does culture intersect your approach to the inclinations and mindset of the people?
I think you have to bear in mind that I am what I would describe as a creative cynic. I'm also an old creative cynic. I think my attitude is very different now from how it would have been in the Archigram period, where one had a kind of faith in the familiar. A lot of the projects I'd done in the early times, though they were considered radical, were actually with a notion that the good old sort of fairly democratic, wet liberal tradition was rather a good one to enjoy. I've never been a Marxist. I was always extremely suspicious of my mainland European contemporaries, who I always said, you can be a Marxist and you've probably got a Mercedes parked around the corner. Of course, there's the effect of teaching. And my wife has observed, who is not from my own culture, she has observed that when she knew me in early days, she thought I was very cosmopolitan. And when she got to know me better, she realized I was as bigoted as the rest, which I hope I'm not. But I think that I have a sort of series of love-hates with many things, and they don't decrease. I am irritated, let's say, by the Austrians sometimes. I think that Mark and I were having a conversation earlier in the day where I trot out my standard conversation about architecture, which is to say, why, if Austria is a tenth of the size of Germany, does it have 10 times as many interesting architects? And there are all sorts of reasons for this, I suppose. And I'm intrigued by the imagination of the Austrians. I'm also often irritated by their perversity and viciousness. And I'm amused by the fact that, well, I wasn't in the office when it happened, but there was a great flurry in the office in Graz because a member of the Habsburgs was going to visit the Duchess of something. But I said, but you don't have them anymore. But indeed they do. And that set me thinking about the sort of what I call the white wine tradition, which I love white wine. I'm hoping to have one in the next half hour. But I'm very cynical. I'm cynical about my friends. I mean, I love them and hate them. And I'm cynical about my town. I love it and see its faults. And I'm another thing, and I think this comes from childhood. Because I had to move many times, I went to 10 schools in 8 cities or 8, whatever it was, a lot of towns. I'd have to get used to a new setup rather quickly. And it makes you make rather quick, perhaps wrong, but rather quick assumptions. And I've just been looking at San Francisco today, and I don't know anything like as well as LA, and haven't been for many years. And the thing immediately strikes me about San Francisco is that it's sort of comfortable old America. It's not edgy. It hasn't got what New York and LA have, and it's not as hard as Chicago. It's rather nice. And it's always been rather nice. And the people from Europe that love LA are different from the people from Europe that love San Francisco. The San Francisco lovers tend to be nice people. And they tend to like, you know, the sort of people who go to Venice as well. Now, that's a terrible thing to say. I've only been here less than 24 hours. But I sniff it. And then, of course, like many people who are rather opinionated, I look for evidence that will support my sniff. If I go down the wrong street and see somebody knifing somebody and somebody yelling and somebody having their tits hanging out, I might say, oh, well, maybe San Francisco isn't quite as nice as I think it is. But so far, and it's sort of old school. It's kind of interesting, the shops. I remember when I first went to Austria, comparing, and I'd been to Germany a few times, it all looked sort of, it had like old underwear in the shop windows. Now, it's not like that anymore, but it certainly was in 1970. And you draw a conclusion from this, and you watch the people that get on the 8 o'clock Lufthansa to Frankfurt and compare them with the people getting on the 8 o'clock Air Austria to Vienna. And they're wearing different jackets. You know, they might be using the same mobile phone and laptop, but they use it. And I'm fascinated. And as I get older, I'm more fascinated by it. And And yet, I also think that architecture can elevate. I'm still old-fashioned enough to think that architecture can elevate. I come in this room, and I'm not being flattering. I think it's a smashing room. It's got to be a good architecture school here. It's bloody got to be with that thing hanging up there and that really rather good railing and you know, a bit of stop the earthquake bracing there and a bit of yellow at the back and a, you know, nice poster. Better poster than most. It's the sniff. I get the sniff of it. I get the sniff. And I go around, not as it knows, it's sniffing. And friends of mine will say one of the terms I use most often is I say, I get a sniff of that. I sniff that this ought to be a good place. I sniff that that's a funny, that's going to be weird down that street. And you sniff. I don't make any claim for it. I am, as I said, I think a creative cynic rather than a negative cynic. But my cynicism is also a defense mechanism which stops you from being disappointed. There's nothing worse than going somewhere that everybody says is a wonderful place. And then you get there and it's, oh yeah, it's all right. Although it sometimes works in reverse as well. I found that Portland, Oregon, about which I'd heard nothing ever, apart from having a funny old Pomo building in it, turned out to be remarkably agreeable, you see? Because I hadn't heard anything about it. Whereas if people, then I met different people, said, yes, Portland is rather a good place. Then if I'd known that, I'd have sort of looked for more. And I think it's the same with your friends, you know? If somebody's built up to be the big, big cheese on something, you know, whereas you just, hey, that guy's rather interesting. And I think that's why the English quite like a quiet person. They like a quiet person who you will discover. We find sometimes, it's terrible, I've got to say something I shouldn't say, we sometimes find North Americans difficult because they're so loud. And my reconstruction of that is because it's a young country where you all spoke different languages, you had to shout in order to try and be understood. But it seems to have lasted rather more generations than it should have done. So it's very difficult to get immediately, you're immediately put off if you're English. I say, fuck, they're so loud, you know, can they have any really sensitive ideas in their head? But then I'm not very sensitive either. So that's another layer, you see. And I'm surrounded by non-English. You know, we've only three English people in the office. My wife's not English, and I have more really close friends who are not English than English. I find a room full of English people incredibly tiresome and boring and predictable, even if we laugh at the same jokes. And I'm fascinated by the Japanese, who have many similarities with the English. They're perverse, they have a cruel sense of humor, they pretend to be honorable, and in fact they piss around. And they like getting drunk and playing with toys and robots and having driving on the left and having damp walls. Many similarities, you see. But this is all bullshit. I mean, it's sort of... But architecture, how can you survive as an architect and just do it by the book? You've got to follow a few leads, you know. And the Travelator one is a sort of up yours, but also it works. It gets you up there, you know, actually. You know, who wants to tramp up a stair when you can go up a travelator? So it's not negative. I love people dearly, but I sometimes think, I think a lot of architects take themselves far too seriously. Hence, many of those cartoons for the Bond project are really sending up particularly younger academics who, as I quite honestly say, you see them position themselves because they want to get tenure. So they're not interested in what's on the wall. They're interested in sounding intelligent or meaningful. And Columbia products do it the most. But that would be another discussion. Does that answer your question? It was a great question. It enabled me to do the supplementary lecture answer.
We have one question from the online. Actually, we have one comment and one question from the online. The comment was, can I borrow his brain? The question will come from Nicole and Bruce.
So this is a question from Braden, who is an instructor here at the Academy. He's watching you virtually. Mm-hmm. Thank you, Sir Peter Cook, for coming and sharing your experiences with us. I'm sure he speaks on behalf of all of us. I think you would agree that architecture ought always to innovate, and one must be radical to innovate. I wonder if you could speak about what you think the importance of absurdity is in the design process. This is to say, breaching the absurd seems almost necessary for you and supremely productive in the design process. Are there any people, memories, or moments that have influenced you regarding the flirtation with the absurd?
Yeah, I would like to share Braden's glass of sherry too in answering his question, if that's what he's drinking right now, or stroking his dog or whatever. You know, you often wonder when, you know, if people are sitting there, you look at them and you're kind of slightly bouncing. The unknown person, whether he has a glass of sherry or a Dalmatian dog or whatever else, or I think there are days. I mean, if you just did everything as a joke, I think it would be disaster. And there are times when you need to be very, very organized. I'm underneath all this sort of joking around, I'm the most boring person at getting to airports early, at making sure that we've finished the competition a day ahead of schedule, if we can, at making sure everybody's had a good lunch, or, you know, there's certain, I'm very sort of boring in many respects, having an hour's sleep before I give this lecture and things like that. And I think you need, and then the absurd, I think the absurd is to do with the edge, too. You look at a project, you know, if somebody came to me and said, you know, can you do this pea packing factory at the back of an East Anglian town, and we've only got a, you know, 50-foot plot or something. You'd then think, I wonder if there are other ways that you could pack peas. Can we do a vertical pea packing factory, or, you know, can we... You sort of think of the silly aspects. So yeah, sure, you can go to, well, you used to say you go to Neufert or Metric Handbook. One of these, now you go to the internet and somebody will tell you exactly what has to be done. You can do it without any idea. You can make sure the pea packing factory and the truck comes in the right place. And you think, it'd be nice for the bloke in the truck to do something while he's waiting for them to load the peas. You know, or, it's a funny old pub across the street. Now, what can we do? You look for the crevices. It's rather like when you go and visit an architect's apartment worldwide, you know there's going to be a copy of SMXL sitting there. So you don't look at that. You look at if there's a copy of the Beekeeper's Weekly or something, or you know, Girly Magazine or Holy Bible or something, which is less likely to find in an architect's apartment. And then you work back from that. You say, if there's a Beekeeper's Weekly, then. I think it's to do with how you comprehend the world, really. You know. And there are funny clues, like it was Yael who commented that the domestic terminal in San Francisco has quite different shops in it from the American Airlines terminal at LAX. Very different. Very, very different. Almost Copenhagen, not quite, but at least halfway there. And that tells you something. You don't need to go to a book. You just need to keep your eyes open. And I gave a lecture a week ago at the Bartlett called Looking. It's purely about looking at things. Because I think that is I've forgotten what the question was about. It was about the absurd, wasn't it? But if you look at things, you can find absurdity. There's a row of shops round the back of where we live, It's a sort of bourgeois suburban area, inner suburb, rather bourgeois. But in recent years, shops have opened that sell coloured cigarettes, which you can hardly buy cigarettes. I mean, I don't smoke, but and snuff, which is from the 19th century, and obscure brands of whiskey. Now, what this shop is doing there, and next to it is a Croatian barber's shop, and next to that is a Belgian chocolate shop. But it's not the smartest part of London. It's a back of the back, and suddenly very good coffee shop. So that's a barometer. All you have to do is to look. You just watch that. Ah, okay, get it. If we were building in this location, we might change the relationship of the main bedroom to the terrace, because that suggests that something's going on. And I think the volatility of people and the volatility of cities implies that there ought to be a greater volatility of the architecture. I think far too much architecture is circumspect. Everybody's worried about doing the wrong thing. You know, there's a sort of political correctness that reaches the drawing board or the layout plan. Whereas I have the feeling that the guys that did the Frankfurt bathroom and bedroom, you know, there's one, Mai and all his friends, they had a vision, they loved people. They wanted them to live better, you know, which is a very old-fashioned thing to say. And they weren't afraid. Does that answer the question? We don't know. He's having another glass of sherry or stroking the dog or whatever he's doing at home there.
Any other questions?
Thank you for sharing the great work. I think aside from the design project, I'm also very interested and fascinated by your drawings. And it seems to me that there's a change from the Archigram period to your later work. From my reading, I feel like the Latin comical satire elements, the influence of pop art seems to have reduced down. So I'm curious to hear from your views like about this change, and if you agree that it is, and also are you seeing some limitations of the representation techniques that lead to the change?
Well, I think there's one very simple thing to say, which is a lot of the more recent stuff is drawn by other people, though I've shown you quite a lot of drawings that I've done myself. So I would say the nearest to a drawing that I really have been engaged in as a drawing would probably be, let's say, that landscape one where I described about the green one done about 4 years ago, where I described the ambiguity between the tectonic and the vegetal in terms of structure. Now that, I think, contains a lot of ideas in it, if I can be arrogant enough. I think it's a nice drawing too, but I think it's very loaded. Loaded, drawn fairly quickly, but took a long time because it's a big drawing. Drawn in Oslo when we were at a Christmas, 2 weeks at Christmas and New Year, on small pieces of paper, brought back to London, joined them up, blew them up a bit bigger, and then coloured them. And the colouring took for ages. But the thinking, there's a lot of thinking going on as I did it. Whereas other drawings are done, you know, let's say the drawings of the little blue building in Bournemouth. There are only one or two bits of that I've drawn myself. It's nearly all been done on a computer and some models made. And I actually developed the project on a balsa wood model. A big one, about so big, where I put the bits together and took them off again and re-glued them and moved them. And most of the thinking of the building was done by fashioning it like a piece of sculpture based on certain ideas. But the drawings, in that case, I've had to do some drawings of it because the people who've raised the money for it, they're already building it, but they still need to raise more money. So my original drawings are part of the sales pitch. So I've been doing after-the-event drawings of the ideas that went into the project, which is a bit funny. Ask about face kind of stuff. But I can't use... I'm computer illiterate, you see. Surrounded by about a dozen people who are very computer literate. I know enough to be able to tell the difference between a drawing that's been done by Meyer and a drawing that's been done by, you know, Rhino, and I can tell that SketchUp is boring, and, you know, I have prejudices amongst watching how people do what they do, but I can't do it myself. I like the idea of hybrid drawings. I like the idea of drawings that start off by being done maybe mechanically and then are tweaked. The Vertical University has a bit of that. It has stuff where I've instructed two people to what to plot on Rhino. A Rhino model is made, and then some bits of drawing produced, and then I come in and I pervert them. I don't know anymore. You know, I'm still doing lectures about drawing. They're mostly about, you know, observing how other people have done them. I think that there's certain... When I mentioned the fountain pen, now that really is important. I like the fact that when you draw with a free, very free-flowing pen, I'm very conscious of the tactile condition of a pen. I don't like using... I hate fiber pens. They drag differently. They don't glide the way a fountain pen will do a certain thing. And a fiber pen doesn't. And a pencil, I was a very grubby student. Whenever I drew in pencil, it all got messy. So I waited. I was wonderful when I could start using ink, rotary pens. I can think freely in ink. Pencil I don't take seriously, and fiber irritates me. Now that sounds very sort of hypersensitive, but it's something to do with how it moves in relation to the way you think. Writing, which I do fairly easily is in a journalistic sense, I'm writing a book right now, I write quite fast, but I can only write like a journal, I can only write like I talk. And then, of course, I'm not fast enough. I'm always thinking about two ideas ahead of what I'm writing. But it reminds me of that same thing, that you need to be able to draw. And what worries me about the computer is that it's so correct. You say to somebody, like, we want to go around and do that. You know, design it so it moves around that post with about a meter and a half clearance. And they will do exactly that. And then you look at it and you think, yeah, they've done what it correctly does. But if I drew it, it would suddenly lurch, maybe. And it would be better. And you can't justify that. There is a rumor that went around a few years ago that in Zaha's office, when they used a very early sort of box-like Macs, that some of her speculations, sort of spatial speculations, were possible until the Mac corrected the mathematics. Now, I don't know how true this is. And that then suddenly you couldn't do them because they were not correct. And so I think I have an issue here, and it's not just with drawing, it implies other things I've been talking about. I have an issue with correctness. Correct is boring. Intention is important, but the deviation can be marvelous, which is again back to drawing, because drawings, great thing about drawings is that they don't have to be correct. They can be better than correct. They can be more interesting than correct. Though, as soon as they dig the hole in the ground and pour the concrete, something is corrected. I don't know whether that answers your question.
Thank you very much. I think we should see fit that we get that glass of sherry. Thank you very much.
I don't like sherry, actually.
Thank you very much. Thank you.